cooling of the Earth has an astrophysical cause. This cause is unstoppable, it is ongoing, unavoidable, and it is knowable. It is presently cooling the Earth, and since it is happening, we can measure the evidence of it, can't we? That's what we see here. The evidence that the Earth is cooling is found in the increasing outflow of cold air from the polar regions. Cold air is heavier than warm air, which causes the cold air from the polar regions to become forced towards the equator by the centrifugal force generated by the rotation of the Earth. This means that the colder the climate gets, the stronger the outflow from the Arctic becomes. On the American continent, the cold northern air, which has a natural westward flow across the northern Canadian landscape that had previously hosted the big ice sheet during the ice ages, becomes trapped by the Rocky Mountain chain in the west and is thereby forced more strongly southward. The strongly focused southward flow flows across the Canadian prairies and south across the Central Straits, which are the main grain-growing areas in North America. Then, deep in the south, the northern airstream slows to a halt and becomes tremendously heated there, especially over the warm waters of the Gulf of Mexico. Since the northern outflow requires a corresponding backflow, the backflow occurs over the Atlantic and draws the warmed up air northward and back into the Arctic region to complete the circulation. This means that the colder the global climate gets, the more the Arctic region gets warmed up. The circulation system has been named the Polar Mobile Anticyclone. Since the rate of flow is now increasing, with the Earth getting colder, the warming of the Arctic is also increasing. The warming of the Arctic is presently a part of the evidence that the Earth is getting colder, but it is the least significant part of the evidence. The increasing cooling of the Earth causes far more dramatic effects than the warming of the Arctic by affecting agriculture. In mid-April 2018, for example, a large winter-type blizzard swept across the American grain belt from the north. It dumped snow on the ground with temperatures in the minus 40 degree range in some areas, and this right in the middle of what should be the planting season. While agriculture recovered from this setback, with planting having been delayed into May, the huge blizzard Santo should nevertheless be seen as the writing on the wall of what we will yet have to face, with the Earth becoming colder year after year for the next 30 years, after which it gets really bad and the next ice age begins. When these large winter blizzards occur in the spring, in April, as we see it here, it is hard to ignore that the Earth is cooling. The next effect will be the collapse of agriculture altogether. At the present rate of cooling, Canada, the European nations, Russia, and similarly situated nations will rapidly cease to exist when the food production breaks down. This could happen in 5 to 15 years. When the cooling climate shrinks the growing season, so that summers become shorter all the way to the point that food plants can no longer mature and produce a harvest, food production begins to collapse. Without food, people die. Without people, there exists no nation. Entire nations are presently situated to vanish by this process when agriculture breaks down. The breakdown is already beginning, slightly though. During the 2018-19 growing season, the world production of wheat, for example, is expected to no longer meet demands, though by a small margin for a start. The shortfall will likely be sequestered from carryover stocks until the reserves are exhausted. For some countries, the shortfall is already severe. In Russia, the wheat production is expected to be down 15%, for the EU bloc 10%, and for Australia 20%, over last year's 40% reduction. These are big numbers, especially when one considers that we are still in the early stage of the diminishing solar activity, which causes the cooling, which will increase for the next 30 years. Australia had suffered a 40% reduction in wheat harvest in the 2017-18 season due to climate effects caused by the solar system's diminishing dynamics. Can we really know that the climate on Earth is forced by the sun? Let's look at the known climate history and compare it with the history of the sun. We know from historic climate records that the Earth has warmed up tremendously after the end of the Little Ice Age. We also know from historic sunspot records that the solar activity has ramped up tremendously during the same time frame. No sunspots had been observed for decades during the Little Ice Age of the late 1600s. Then the sunspots came back from 1715 onward and increased ever more, and the Earth warmed up coincidental with the increasing solar activity. Now we have huge numbers of sunspots again, at least we had so in the late period of the solar global warming between the 1960s and the late 1990s. With the high numbers of sunspots that we had in this period, which correspond to high intensity solar activity, the experienced climate on Earth was also the warmest in modern history. The matching relationship proves rather conclusively that the climate on Earth is linked to solar activity. It has also been discovered that the sun emits not only light and heat, but also emits cosmic reflux in an inverse relationship to its solar activity. The inverse relationship results because in times when the solar activity is high, the sun is surrounded with a denser plasma corona, where much of the solar cosmic reflux is trapped. It has been discovered that the historic solar activity can be measured by measuring the presence of a rare radioisotope that is produced by cosmic ray interaction with the atmosphere. The historic ratios of this isotope closely match the historically counted sunspot numbers and the historically known climate patterns. This tells us that the changing solar activity intensity affects the Earth's atmosphere with changing cosmic ray flux, which in turn affects the Earth's climate by affecting the cloud-forming process. How big the effect is of cosmic ray flux affecting our atmosphere has been explored at the CERN laboratory in Europe with the cloud experiment. A large test chamber had artificial cosmic rays injected, and the effects were measured. When the cosmic rays were turned on, the measured aerosol nucleation went straight up and off the chart, which proves in principle that solar cosmic ray flux has an enormous effect on the cloud nucleation in our atmosphere. This means that when solar activity is low, by which solar cosmic ray flux is high, the cloud-forming process is more intense. As a consequence, the Earth becomes colder, because increased cloudiness reflects a larger portion of the incoming sunlight back into space, which becomes lost to the heat budget of the Earth. By this interaction, changing solar activity has huge effects on our climate. Another effect of solar activity on our climate is located in the ultraviolet spectrum of the sunlight. It has been discovered that a large portion of the sunlight that is absorbed in the Earth's atmosphere is absorbed in the ultraviolet band of the spectrum by oxygen and by the scattering effect. It has been further discovered that the UV band is the first to be affected by changing solar activity. Satellite observation of the Sun in the extreme UV band had measured dramatic variations of solar radiation over the span of a solar cycle. The variation had been reported to be as high as 23-fold. By this principle, solar activity variations affect the climate by affecting the greenhouse of the Earth, while cosmic rays affect our climate by affecting cloudiness. These variations are big, while carbon gases affect almost nothing. The images shown here are for solar cycle 23. The current solar cycle, cycle 24, is significantly weaker, with the next one likely becoming weaker still. This means that the Earth is getting colder and will continue to cool ever more. The cooling of the Earth affects agriculture. Note, our entire modern civilization developed during the 300 years period of the solar global warming. The USA and Canada were formed during this period. This means that our food production capability that is rooted in global warming agriculture is fast reversing because solar activity is fast diminishing. As I will demonstrate later, solar activity is diminishing at a 5 times faster rate than it was ramped up during the solar global warming period. This fast rate of climate collapse affects the entire world population. It took humanity 200,000 years to grow in numbers to 500 million people that we had in the 1600s, and only 300 years thereafter to reach the 7 billion level that we have today. The enormous population increase occurred during the 300 years period of the grand solar global warming that ended the Little Ice Age. Humanity grew from 600 million to 7,000 million in 300 years of global warming, and with scientific and technological process happening in the background. Both factors flowing together gave rise to the modern civilization. Evidently, the climate warming is a bigger contributing factor than we may realize. During the cold of the Little Ice Age, agricultural production had been so deeply depressed that people had resorted to cannibalism in some areas. Now, at the end of the solar global warming period, we have enough food available on the Earth to nourish 10 times as many people than we had when the warming began. However, the dynamics that gave us this rich harvest are now reversed. The reversal happened in the 1990s. Solar activity, and with it our climate, are now collapsing 5 times faster than they had ramped up. The solar activity gain, and with it the climate gain, of the entire last 250 years period up to the 1960s, which leveled off till the 1990s, is now ending at such a rapid rate that the entire global warming gain will be lost by the 2030s or 2040s, and the loss be superseded in the 2050s, when the Ice Age phase shift potentially begins. The upramping of the historic solar activity has been measured in carbon-14 isotope ratios until the dawn of the atomic bomb that also produces carbon-14, which had obsoleted the measuring process. After the solar activity reversal, the rate of collapse in solar activity was measured by the Ulysses spacecraft in terms of diminishing solar wind pressure. Both the rate of the upramping and of the subsequent collapse are quantified by technological physical measurements. The measurements tell us that the global warming that we have enjoyed, especially from the 1900s on, in which modern civilization had developed, was a solar cast anomaly that is now rapidly ending. The Ulysses spacecraft flew 3 polar orbits around the Sun between 1994 and 2008. It measured the solar wind pressure diminishing at a rate of 30% per decade. The Sun fending off excess plasma pressure in the form of solar wind is comparable to a kettle of water fending off steam. When the energy input is reduced, the steam diminishes and stops. On the Sun, The solar wind diminishes and then stops for much the same reason. If one projects the measured rate forward, the solar wind will cease in the 2030s. After that, the solar temperature will begin to diminish until the primary fields for the sun collapse and the ice age phase shift happens, potentially in the 2050s. The Ulysses spacecraft was the first to quantitatively measure the rate of the solar activity's collapse. We see the same high rate of collapse also reflected in diminishing sunspot numbers, as one would expect, because both reflect solar activity. We also see the 30% rate of collapse in solar activity, which Ulysses had measured, to be continuing on after Ulysses. We see the 30% per decade rate reflected in the form of increasing neutron flux measurements conducted by the Moscow Neutron Monitor. We see in them increasing volumes of solar cosmic ray flux being emitted. The increase results when the corona around the sun becomes weaker, which traps cosmic ray flux. The resulting increase in cosmic ray flux is measured in the form of increasing neutron flux that cosmic rays generate. That the majority of the cosmic ray flux is solar rather than galactic in its origin is evident in the measured fact that the cosmic ray variations follow the solar cycles. Further proof that cosmic rays are mostly solar resulted from a chemical reaction experiment that was continuously repeated in an identical manner. At one point, however, large spikes in the reactivity were measured, occurring in 24-hour intervals, according to the rotation of the Earth. But with the spikes diminishing according to the rotation of the sun, it appears that a coronal hole occurred that had enabled large volumes of cosmic reflux to flow from the sun, which became smaller in volume as the coronal hole turned away from the Earth. Another measured proof that coronal holes on the sun emit large showers of cosmic rays that affect the climate on Earth is evident in the reported flash flood event in May 2015, at a time when large coronal holes erupted on the sun. This means that as solar cosmic reflux is now increasing with the weakening sun, cloudiness is increasing accordingly, with the Earth becoming correspondingly colder thereby, year after year. Another proof that the 30% per decade rate of collapse in solar activity that the Ulysses satellite has seen still continues is evident in the continuing collapse of the solar radio flux measurements that have been reported. One researcher who is familiar with the collapsing radio flux measurements in the 10.7 centimeter band had warned in a comment, "The sun is dying. You have 3 years to get out of Europe before they close the borders." Of course, the sun isn't actually dying. The sun cannot die. However, the dynamics of the larger solar system that the Sun is a part of are diminishing. The timing of the peaks of the sunspot numbers tells us that the solar system's heartbeat is slowing down. The 11 years solar heartbeat had slowed from 11 years to 13 years between the peaks of cycle 23 and 24. The next heartbeat may be as slow as 16 years per cycle, which is speculation, of course, though the dynamics of the current change point in that direction. This means, in summary, that we have five different types of physical measurements on hand that all tell us in their own way that the Sun-caused global warming anomaly is over and is fast collapsing. Of course, not all measurements are quantifiable in measured terms, but are nevertheless significant. Plisotsando in April 2018, with its massive snow and deep minus temperatures, is evidence that the Earth is cooling, though the rate of cooling is hard to quantify on this basis. These general types of anomalies, however, have become more frequent. Reduced food production, like Australia's 40% reduction in wheat harvest in 2018 due to climate change, is another type of evidence that the Earth is cooling, but which cannot quantify the cooling itself. In the case of Australia, the loss was caused by drought. Drought is caused when increased solar cosmic reflux ionizes clouds that thereby rain out faster and reduce water vapor that reduces the greenhouse protection. The chance for a cyclical climate recovery to happen is physically observable, although it is not quantifiable because the chance for this to happen is zero. We see measurements conducted in ice that tells us that the big historic warming pulses have been diminishing over the last 3,000 years, both in amplitude and in the length of their intervals. With the current global warming pulse being the fourth one in line, and it being quite small, we won't see another one of this type for a long time to come. The Ice Age phase shift will be upon us much sooner. The historic 250 years climate cycles of the last 1,000 years that are associated with the little ice ages have likewise diminished. The amplitude of their fluctuation has become extremely small. We are definitely not rushing towards another grand solar minimum again that we can recover from, such as the Maunder minimum. Instead, we are rushing towards the grand solar termination that ushers in the next ice age. The short-term fluctuations have diminished, both in amplitude and intervals. Their intervals have become extremely short thereby, and their amplitudes extremely weak. There is nothing left in this system, too, that could give us a recovery from this now ongoing climate collapse. This means that when the current global warming pulse ends, that has pulled us out of the little ice age and is now collapsing, no recovery will happen. The collapse will simply continue towards the grand interglacial termination, which will happen potentially in the 2050s. When climate explorers speak of the grand solar minimum occurring, they assume that a recovery will follow. They assume that the sun is its own master and will continue to cycle on as it had 1,000 years ago, when there was a lot of life left in the solar system dynamics. But all this is gone. The sun is not its own master. It is mastered by external conditions that are rapidly becoming weaker. The advertised assumption that a cyclical recovery will occur, which isn't possible anymore, has tragic consequences, because the dreaming of a recovery prevents the building of a real solution, the building of a climate-independent new world. The world will be in deep trouble when the current climate collapses to the termination point, without a new world having been built along the way, because then the wonderful warm climate that has enabled us to become a 7 billion world population will collapse into deep, cold ice age conditions. Right now, we find us still enjoying the benefits of the last 300 years of global warming that ended only 20 years ago. However, we are at the beginning of what might be called the boundary zone towards the next ice age phase shift. In this boundary zone, the world is getting colder with increasing drought conditions year after year for another 30 years potentially. In the boundary zone, agriculture, as we know it, ends. But what will happen to our 7 billion world population in the boundary zone? The answer depends on us all in today's time. Will we build us a new world? One way or another, it can be said with certainty that we haven't seen anything yet. This means the writing is on the wall. If we don't have a new world built with indoor agriculture in the tropics, by the time the collapse becomes critical, the 7 billion world population that we have become will then expire by starvation. Almost all of modern civilization has developed during the global warming anomaly. The world population has increased tenfold in the 300 years period of global warming. Both Canada and the USA were formed quite early during the upswing of it. Unless we put the spade into the ground soon and start to build us a technological new world that the climate collapse cannot touch, everything that had been achieved, that we have become, our entire 7 billion people world civilization, will collapse without recourse with the collapsing climate. A recourse is only possible before the collapse begins. The window of opportunity is still open, but it appears to be closing fast. The new world in the tropics, when we get it built, will be a world of technological infrastructures afloat on the equatorial seas for the lack of suitable land in the tropics for the scale of the project. The vast new infrastructures can be built that would enable productive agricultures to continue to operate in a dramatically cooler world, even under full ice age conditions. No miracles are required for such infrastructures to be built. The materials, energy resources, and technologies are on hand. The project would enable the whole of humanity to continue to live on this planet and prosper. What makes large-scale floating platforms attractive over other options is that by their uniformity, they can be manufactured more easily than any other alternative, with fully automated industrial processes, utilizing high-temperature nuclear power and basalt as feedstock. This type of process would enable a vast new industrial revolution. In addition, floating platforms with technologically driven indoor agriculture are immune to flooding, earthquakes, and volcanic eruptions, which are presently increasing. The new lands for the new agriculture, located afloat under the equatorial seas, with floating cities attached to service the floating agriculture, would be linked with an intercontinental transportation bridge. The entire project could start to function as a new food production infrastructure almost from the start, even while it is being built, as soon as the industries have been built to build the infrastructures. How soon this will happen depends on the efforts that will be made to get the process started, and also on the scale of the commitment that results. With the new world infrastructure put in place, the nations of Canada, Europe, Russia, and so on will have a place to go to continue to exist when their present territories cease to enable food production at home. At the present rate of cooling, food production in Canada, Europe, and Russia will collapse dramatically within the next 5 to 15 years. The USA, India, and China will likely be affected in similar manners. Wheat production in China is already diminishing, and likely in the USA also. In fact, the entire world is already affected. The global food supply crisis is not something that may begin in distant future time. The collapse has begun. Most governments are presently finding ways to cope with it. But for how long? The rate of agricultural losses will increase in the years to come, as the earth continues to cool year after year, for 30 more years, under steadily diminishing astrophysical conditions. If the new world infrastructures are not built and operational when the large-scale agricultural collapse happens, which will affect wide areas simultaneously, worldwide population collapse will result by starvation. This collapse will be man-made if it happens. It will be the consequence of political inaction in our time. it will be a man-made consequence of the type of political inaction that presently prevents the necessary world bridge construction to become considered and implemented at the present stage, while time is running out. The current political environment all across the climate change front has these types of suicidal consequences for as long as the mental environment is not uplifted onto the level of reality, while time remains. Fortunately, there is now hope on the horizon on this front, with a presidential committee on climate change becoming formed that might yet succeed at the near-term stage to raise the banner of truth. While the truth is presently officially declared dead in climate science, or settled, as it is now called, settled in the coffin of grand fakery, it can be raised nevertheless to life again. It appears to be not possible for the truth to become violated with fakery forever and hidden under lies of political objectives in the long run, because reality remains what it is and asserts its claim. Society may have been politically forced to close its eyes to reality, but it cannot avoid the consequences that ultimately speak louder than politics. And so it appears that people are waking up. They most certainly will awake when the food supply is beginning to collapse, as is now faintly happening already. Then even the politically dead are bound to be roused into action. Hopefully this will happen while the chance remains to create solutions before food riots will erupt in the streets. With this in mind, it appears that there is a political movement unfolding towards sanity in our time, and perhaps just under the political horizon. The awakening movement towards sanity appears to have enabled the American president, President Trump, to propose or to order the launching of a truth-finding commission named the Presidential Committee on Climate Science. That's what the Washington Post has reported on February 20, 2019. It evidently takes a great deal of personal courage by President Trump to make this type of proposal, considering the colossal outrage the proposal would immediately stir up among the Democrats, among the climate campaigners, and among the vast scene of renewable energy interests and related interests who profit immensely from the currently operating $2 trillion per year global climate hoax industrial complex. And even at that, should the Presidential Committee on Climate Science actually be formed against the chorus of opposition voices from the climate change profiteers, the committee might not have the courage to address the real climate change issue at hand, which is the ongoing cooling of the earth and the diminishing food production resulting as a consequence, for which the evidence is already glaringly real and has been measured in numerous different ways. It is likely that without public support for the truth, the selected committee will debate meaningless details of meaningless lies, as had been done at the Paris Climate Change Conference, for reasons that it is politically risky in the sciences to speak the truth. If the truth would matter to society, there would be no debate happening at all, because the case of the truth is clear. It is well known in the sciences that CO2, the politically postulated villain, is not a climate factor at all in real terms. My supporting work that stands behind this series is a resource that provides further details that you may wish to explore.
Joy.